Everyone sit down. Everyone, wave your hands in the air like you just don't care. I'm going to be very hot by the end of the day. I know I'm good looking to begin with, but it's very, very hot. All right, ready to go? Ready for some fun?
Yeah.
That was weak.
Yeah.
Come on, guys. You ready to have some fun? Slightly. Who's Jack? This is going to be the best day of your life. So it's going to be a decent day for most of you. We'll see what I can do about that. All right. So, who was here last year? Can you raise your hands?
Hey, yeah.
A decent crew of you. Okay. So, Michelle didn't kind of learn the lesson that when you bring a ridiculous person in to speak, you don't bring them back the next year. Because I only have one bout of ridiculousness, so... I'm very glad to be back with you guys. I have soft spots in my heart for Regina. You know, because I'm from Saskatoon, so we pray for your souls often. This is our outreach to you. So I'm glad to be of service to you guys. Maybe you can be like us one day. It's a great way to get the audience on your side. It's awesome to be here, but I have a habit of sometimes going off script and doing some craziness. So if I happen to start telling you a story that I told you last year, you need to, like, do something. Maybe not like a shoot in the face, slightly down from there, but not like a whisper, enough to be like, "Hey, Colin, we heard that lame joke." And I'm like, "Oh, okay, I'll move on." Hey, is that a deal? Two thumbs up? Excellent. Okay, well, last year, my family was here, but they're not. So that's sad. And then we go, So, but I did bring some video clips of Jacinta Nezer for you again, just to be fair with that. So, today, and the theme of the weekend is show and no mercy. I was trying to find a clip, but I had to break a lot of priority laws, so I wasn't able to do it, because I just started to feel guilty. But when I first thought of that, I was thinking, N-O mercy. So for all, you know, the wrestling fans out there, I thought it was going to be a wrestling thing from No Mercy, one of their pay-per-view events. And I felt like maybe Batista's going to show up or John Cena. And then I was like, oh, it's showing no K-N-O-W. I was like, oh, it's like all love stuff. But I promise it'll still be fun. So really, to show and to know mercy is the essence of being a Christian, what it's all about. So I want you guys to share how you are showing and how you're coming to know mercy this weekend. So who's on Snapchat? Raise your hand. Okay, I have slowly discovered Snapchat, and I'm like that 7-year-old man discovering Facebook, to watch the grandkids and all that kind of stuff. So bear with me as I learn filters and tools, but I'm on Snapchat, so apparently you can take a picture of that, or just search Colin Line, and you can add me, and then I have my story, a public story, and I'll just be sharing behind the scenes photos and stuff and videos throughout the weekend, maybe a little interview clips of you guys and how it's going. And then on Instagram as well, I'm on there, and you guys should be on too. We have a hashtag, I believe, I don't know if I put it on there, oh, my fail, which is MyGenYQR, is that right?
Yes!
That is right. So please use that hashtag so I can see the wonderful things that you're doing this afternoon. That's awesome. And that's a way of us evangelizing the world online. And our parents, our family, our friends, and my wife, who wants to be here so she can live vicariously through Snapchat and Instagram. Is that a deal? Cool. Well, token speaker thing, you need pictures of my kids, so there you go. There's Ezra and Jacinta climbing over me. There's my wife. She's much more beautiful than I am. Well, I think I'm decent. Alright? Announcement. So, last year was, we're going to make a mess. And I just wanted to let you know that our family took that quite literally, especially one person in particular. So here's your first little video.
Hi, my name is Jacinta. You might remember from such videos as Teapot's Finger and Chip or Death Trap. This is my brother Ezra, but I like to call him the Destroyer. Really excited having a baby brother, but these things should come from giggles, but they're really just out to get you. So be warned. Lock everything.
Ezra the Destroyer. You have a decision to make. Mercy starts at home. Mercy starts in our own lives. It's not complicated. It's hard. It's hard for Jacinta, who ran the house for a few years, now to have to deal with the Destroyer, right? She loves him until he screws with her stuff, right? We love life until somebody gets in our way, or says a mean word, or discourages us, right? Or we have a failure. Right? Mercy is how we experience those occasions, how we experience God's love and compassion, but also how we extend it. Okay? And this morning we're going to talk more about the show side of it to prep you guys, because that's what you're going to go do. And then we'll talk about knowing mercy in a deeper way this evening. But we have a decision to make before we do any of this. Okay? You got to be, it says in the Bible, be scalding hot, freezing cold. But if you are lukewarm, I will spit you out. You gotta make a stance. You gotta stand up for something. So, I need you all to stand up. And I need you all to stand up. All right, you're more than ready to do this game. Standing and sitting is gonna wear on you, whatever, that stuff. You can do a hand action, that works as well. All right. I'm going to give you an option. If you agree, stand up. If you don't, sit down. Okay? Is Rey Luke Skywalker's daughter? We don't know. That's not a spoiler. Yes, stand up. No, sit down. Divergent movie, The Legion, which comes out soon. Okay, not bad. Don't hesitate, either yes or no. Who is in love with Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt on Netflix? Anyone watch that show? This is a disservice to humanity that you have not watched that show. It's hilarious. Alright. You have a free Friday night. Okay, I'll give you an option. You can either stay home and chill on the couch and snuggle up with a book or your favorite pet. If that's the case, you will sit down. That's really interesting. If you'd rather go up, go out, and hang out with your friends, stand up. We got one big snuggle party happening here. Excellent. Okay, very good. All right, you can have a seat. The point of that is that we actually just need to exercise and move our bodies around, because it's really hard for speakers for you guys to sit there forever. So there's method to my madness. But also, you guys need to make a decision. At some point in our lives, it's not just when you get married or if you, you know, enter priesthood or religious life, you need to make a decision today, in the next minute, in the next 10 minutes, because you need to start thinking about your legacy. You need to start thinking about your eulogy. That's what people say when you die. What are the stories? What's going to be your story on Snapchat when you enter the pearly gates? Are you going to be proud of it? Are you going to have regrets? Is there going to be opportunities you let slide thinking there was another one to come? Your legacy as a Christian starts now. Start the moment you are hot in God's mind. You don't need a certificate or a certain age to have a legacy, to have impact. You don't have to be a famous speaker. You don't have to be a youth minister. You don't have to be my favorite person in the world, Michelle Braden, right? All wonderful things. You need to be you and the best version of yourself by making the best decisions for yourself, in light of eternity. And that requires us to ask a question. Jesus to you? It's kind of a simplified argument, but C.S. Lewis kind of put it this way. Either Jesus is a liar, he was mad crazy, or he was who he said he was. Someone threw a legend in there too, but the main three. He's a liar, he's crazy, or he was who he said he was. Maybe you know what you think of that answer, and maybe you don't, and that's okay. I'm not here to judge. I'm here to share my answer for me, my story, and what have I experienced in other people in my ministry and my life so far. Because it's okay to be curious. It's okay to doubt. It's okay to have problems trusting. Those are all stages of discipleship. Right? Even Peter, his rock, was the greatest doubter and failed at Jesus' time of need. Was Peter a failure? Yes, in that sense, but no, in a much greater sense. Not the victories. Peter knocked it out of the park. Jose Bautista bat flipped his way to heaven. Right? Blue Jays fan. So, who is Jesus to you? I want you to start thinking about that today, because you're going to have a chance to meet him when you go out into the world. And the world is going to have a chance to meet him in you. And then you're going to have a chance to meet him in purest form, body, blood, soul, and divinity. At adoration tonight, mass tomorrow. You can have a chance to have a conversation. Say, Jesus, I came here today, and you know what? We weren't Facebook friends. I wasn't following your story on Snapchat, aka the Gospels. So much needs to start this in check. I don't care where you came from. Like, what stage of life are you? What I care about is, how are you going to leave? That's our job here this weekend. That you can struggle with these questions, that you can take them to your Lord, and duke it out. Right? There's a place in our faith to be like, yo, Jesus, what up? I have problems. I have problems with sick kids. A good friend of our family in Texas, the little boy, has leukemia. He was born, he has Down syndrome, with a lot of children that struggle with Down syndrome, has heart problems, weak heart. And he's been a trooper. Right? And he just keeps going. Superhero Joey, hashtag, check it out on Facebook. Right? And this little guy has been in and out of the hospital for years, basically. And in about the last year, figured out they had leukemia. So he's into his third round, I think he just finished his chemotherapy. Great, wonderful family, supportive, the communities around them, they're praying for them, they're giving them meals, all these good things. For a while, the oldest sister couldn't go to the hospital, couldn't see him because they're worried about infection. So the family's been split, the mom's staying at the hospital, you know, the dad, Jose, who's a cop, is being the night cop, he's doing the night watch, taking care of the other two kids. I have a hard time with that. I can pray and do all the right things, but I'd be lying if I haven't stayed up at night, saying, yo, Jesus, why Joey? Why him? And fill in the blank, we know so many Joeys or whoever, right? Why all the struggles with refugees? Everything that's going on. It's okay to ask those questions. It's okay if you don't think you know the answer or you're not okay with the answer. But I just ask you to struggle, to lean into it. And more than anything, just to let go. And trust. And trust that we're here for one another and God is here for you. Even if you don't believe it, I'm here to tell you that He is. And it's my distinct prayer that you will encounter him in a profound way. And you'll remember this when you get to Good Friday this year.
It was all part of God's plan.
miserable Friday. If you believe that, then maybe we're not like going to be jumping around on Good Friday and be like, it's a good Good Friday. People might find that a little weird. Right? But the whole thing with Easter and Lent, if you don't take the whole story together, none of it makes sense. Right? If giving up candy or Facebook or me doing the dishes every night, even when I'm exhausted, right? Because that's the little thing that I said I was going to do. Right? If we don't understand how that fits into everything else, you're going to stop. You're going to give up. It's the same thing with suffering in our lives. If we can't place suffering into a bigger context, you're never going to make sense of it. And even when you can place it into the bigger story, it's still hard. I know that Christ died for our sins. That's the kerygma, we call it the basic gospel, right? That God, who is love, right? I talked about this last year. You know, the Father and the Son, they love each other fully, right? And the life-giving love is the Holy Spirit, and it's flying all over the place, right? Shooting little Holy Spirit darts of grace all over the place. Just gonna nail it. Right? And we have the freedom to choose love. And sometimes, as humanity, we have fractured that relationship. And so God sent His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. True God and true man, He came, He dwelt among us, He lived with us, He lived in our suffering. Right? Born to a teenage mom. Right? To scandal, potentially. She wouldn't get stoned normally. Right? In that society. Adopted father, you know, stepdad. Died very young, probably, in Jesus' life. Right? He experienced suffering. His best friend died, the shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. He knows suffering so that He could take it on that cross on a Good Friday so that you may be redeemed and you may enter into that love fully and completely now and forevermore. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. If we believe that, everything is different. You can't just go at Netflix, you know, and hang out. Go play basketball tomorrow. If suddenly you figure that out today, you can't do it the same that you did before. We like to say that Jesus is the new Adam and Mary is the new Eve. And that through His grace, through His mercy, we become new. We have an opportunity to turn around every day of our lives and to run to the Father. Knowing that He's on that porch and He's just waiting to give you a chest bump, high five, off we go. $5 to anyone who does that after confession tonight, just throw that out there. Right? Because that's, you're going to encounter your loving Father. Everything changes if you believe that Christ died for you. It alters the entire way that our family runs. On that slide before, right, is that we choose to serve the Lord. Does He choose to serve me by becoming as low as possible? Mercy, and I'll talk about this again tonight, is personal and is specific. When you encounter it, when you know it, and when you show it. When you go out this afternoon, right, you will show mercy personally and how you offer it, and to people individually, and in a specific way. You're all going to do different things. Through how you bowl and you cheer with the Special Olympics. Through how you listen to someone at a care home. To how you serve or play games with inner city children playing hockey. All these different options are an opportunity to personally, in a specific way, share and encounter God's mercy. But we can do that first because He has done that for us. Jesus didn't die for everyone else on the earth except you. He died just for you, and just for you, and just for you, and just for you, and just for you. In a personal way, for you. He comes into your darkness, and He draws you forth into the light. We'll talk about that a little bit. Have mercy. Who else is excited that Fuller House came back? What a wonderful and great thing. It changes everything. And if you're here last year, we'll know what happens next.
Shepherds
kind of were jerks a little bit, right, sometimes. So this idea of taking it, and he was trying to use our culture, but then to show really the love about it, right? So you hear the story that the little sheep that would be on Jesus' shoulder in those images, or in a picture of the Good Shepherd, it's kind of twisted, but it makes sense. It's not there because it's too small to go, or it hurt itself. Often shepherds would intentionally break one of the legs of the baby sheep. And the idea is that so they wouldn't get lost or run away, right? And that it would know to stay close to the shepherd, that he could care for it until it was bigger and stronger, right? And so then the Good Shepherd would carry the sheep around. Isn't that neat? So in this story, there's a guy representing that sheep, right? That in our brokenness, Jesus comes to heal us and take care of us and journey with us. And that dude is Adam. Remember Adam and Eve, the whole story? Right? Now if you look, there's something kind of awkward going on right now. Can anyone point it out? Hey, they have three eyes. Three between the two of them, right? They share one eye. And that's not because like they just screwed up on the picture and they're like, oh shoot, we printed all these cards. Let's go with it. Right? There's totally a meaning to it. Okay? So the idea is that when we draw close to Christ, and Christ came in his incarnation and dwelt among us, that he came to see through the lens of humanity, that he saw as Adam saw. And also that when we draw close, we go cheek to cheek and we encounter his mercy and his love, and we try to become more like Jesus, we then begin to see with the Father's eye, with God's eye. So that we can be able to see ourselves and see humanity as Jesus sees us, as God's beloved. Other cool things about there, you'll see the little circles of blue. So that represents, it goes darker to lighter as it comes out. It represents that Jesus comes, right, on Good Friday and Easter, that he goes into the darkness of our sin and our life, and he has drawn us forth out of our darkness, out of our sin. So it's him coming out darkness. That's why it gets lighter, the crazier it goes. The gold represents that as we draw closer to God and Adam, we become more like God. So the gold representing the royalty that Jesus, you know, God is Lord, the Lord of Lords, King of Kings. Okay? White represents divinity. Red usually represents blood, life. Okay? And what else do we have here that I didn't mention? Okay, the theme of the year, merciful, like the Father. Okay, the good Father. We talked about the prodigal Son as well, all those kind of stories. And well, there's one I missed. Oh, it's in the shape of an almond. Apparently, Christians really love almonds. Did you know this? It's a thing. Like, going back hundreds and hundreds of years, that they love the shape of an almond. Because it looks like two circles coming together. Do you see that? It's like two circles coming to face each other. And that represents, right, the twofold nature of Christ. That he's fully God and fully man. He's an almond. That's awesome! When you first look at that, you're like, it's a creepy dude with one eye. Look at all the stuff we just learned. Right? Get to know our art, our history, our symbols. That's the best thing about being Catholic, man. We do up symbols like nobody's business. If you're a Ukrainian Catholic, you're like just cheating, you're hacking life. Okay? Just go to Divine Liturgy once in a while, it's awesome. They got incense, they sing, icons everywhere. It's amazing, right? And the idea of an icon is we call it that it is, it's like a window, right? So you actually pray with them. Because when you look upon it, the idea is that you are looking at God. You're looking into the face of God who shines forth through the humanity, right, through the image of these saints or of Jesus himself. So, yes, it's a little bit creepy, but it's beautiful and powerful. It reminds us of God's mercy. So, let us remember that we have been loved first. Loved first. And you are called to love first. Pope Francis is a smart dude. It's not an accident that he's called this year of mercy. It's not an accident that it seems to be his calling card and what he did in Argentina. He's just being himself. The Pope isn't like, my goal in life is to be the best Pope ever. He's just being him. You know how this phrase is, you do you, and I do me? Pope is doing Pope. He's being Berkey, right? He's being Horan. He's just being who he has been called to be. And he's sharing it with the world, saying, you know what? We need to love first, because we have been loved first, like I already said. Personally, in a specific way, right? And unconditionally. God's mercy doesn't tap out, the well never runs dry. If you think you came and you knew Christ and you did something really messed up this year and you think, got no chance, God says, you can always take a chance on me. There's always more to give. And as you go out this afternoon, some of you, it might be easy, for some of you, it would be very hard, but I challenge you, you have more to give. You have more power inside of you than you understand. But it needs to be tapped. We gotta let it flow. We gotta give what we have to truly encounter. This is a nice little picture of our man. And the little line, mercy within mercy within mercy. That's from Thomas Merton. He's a big, he's a genius. He should be a saint. He's not officially a saint, but in my mind he is. And that's the motto of my bishop, my boss in Saskatoon. He took that. And big whoops from Bishop Don. He's a Regina. He's from your world, yes. Thank you. So a couple things come from Regina. So he took this idea of mercy within mercy within mercy. This comes from a story that Thomas Merton wrote about Jonas. And it's God kind of speaking through Merton. And he says, Jonas was a trial. Don't you know that you have been overshadowed by my love and mercy? Mercy within mercy within mercy. And so when Bishop Don was writing, because the bishops had to make like these fancy coat of arms and that kind of stuff, and then they put the words at the bottom. It has to go like to some official place like you can. It's like a big ordeal apparently. And praying, hopefully you have a new one here, and then you'll get to experience that. And learn about your new bishop and your bashful bishop's logo. It tells you their story, what they're about. And so the dude who does all the fancy stuff calls up Bishop Don and says, are you sure you want three mercies? Isn't it kind of redundant? You know, mercy within mercy. What do you need the third one for? We get the idea. We like mercy. And Bishop Don says, that's exactly the point. God goes beyond what we require. Mercy within mercy. To know that no matter what you do, no matter how you think of yourself, mercy within mercy within mercy. God is always there, and he's willing to give. And we are called to replicate that. And to give. Mercy, and mercy, and mercy. You are not too young. You are not too old. You're not too short or tall. You're not too cool or lame or geeky. We all have the ability to use our hands. We all have the ability, right, in a physical or a spiritual sense, right? In the way that we speak and communicate, do we lift people up or do we tear them down? Mercy within mercy within mercy. It sounds like I'm being redundant. It's because I am. It's simple, but it's hard. Pope Francis said this, amongst other things. Beyond all our own preferences and interests, our knowledge and motivations, we evangelize for the greater glory of the Father who loves us. Everything that you will do today and the rest of your life is not your doing. I need to bring it to you. Okay? You might have some control. Everything that you are and will be and have to offer to this world is because of God and what he first has done unto us. So now we go and do unto others. Okay? It's because of the Father's great love for us that we're able to give a hug, that we're able to cry, that we're able to cry again, that we're able to sit on the porch quiet, that we're able to say no, to spend time drinking tea with a friend, that we're able to have a moment of silence to let God speak to our hearts. All of this is because God is first loved us. My remember this from last year. Jerks for Jesus, anyone remember that? Did I not talk about Jerks for Jesus last year?
No.
I didn't talk about Catholic jerks or just jerks?
Yeah.
Oh, I just didn't say Jerks for Jesus. Yeah. I like hashtags. Right? The idea is, if you're gonna be a Christian or Catholic of the world, you know, that old lame song, they'll know we are Christians by our love, right? Not by our jerkiness. May they know you are a Christian, not because you have a t-shirt or a cross or that you say you're from the MindGen rally. May they know that you represent Christ because you are Christ unto them. Does that make sense? Right? You can get the t-shirt. You can get the cross. That's good too. But if they can't see it in our words and actions, you've missed the point. You've missed the point. Okay? So I've challenged myself in Lent and different things to do that we need to share, we need to speak, we need to show in our actions. And someone was like, oh, we should write a book. And I was like, ah, oh, whatever. So I'm going to write a book, Jerks for Jesus. Comes out August 2016. It'll probably be free because no one would really buy that book. It's very bad marketing. But the point is why I decided to do it, and I'll have that jerk exam I talked about last year. Right, is just like Jeremiah, one of the young prophets, right? Is that I have a word inside of me and I can't contain it. God has loved me in my brokenness, and I gotta do something about it. I gotta dance, I gotta talk, I gotta write. What do you gotta do? Right? When you're dancing in your chair tonight, you know, at adoration. Your heart's pumping and your hands are sweating, right? And you're like, what's going on? Gus, what do you want me to do, right? That's him telling you what you've got to do. Pay attention to that moment. Don't run away from it. Allow yourself to be vulnerable. As you go out and experience today, you'll have some guys who I think have spent time being incarcerated who will be here on Sunday to share their story, which I think is going to be amazing. So a few years ago for Lent, and I was like, oh, to give alms. I was like, is that like your palms? I didn't understand what that is. It's like, you know, to go give service. And so Diane Anderson, who coordinates visitation and doing stuff in prison ministry, needed volunteers. So my wife and I signed up, and we went at different times. And I remember the first time I went, I was like, I'm going to get knifed or killed or something. Straight out of like Prison Break episode or I don't know. And I was so afraid. So unreasonably afraid. Petrified. I'm like, this tall, lanky, awkward white guy, you guys know this, you have a second year to enjoy this. Right? And they go to the, you know, buzz the gate, and they gave us not really good directions to get buzzed. It's kind of, it's called Irving Camp, so it's the guys that are kind of in transition. They go and work during the day, but then they stay there, so they're kind of on the way up. And so I get buzzed in the gate, and I walk up. It's just like a field. Here's, in my mind, a bunch of gangsters just hanging out on the porch, you know, smoking, and this, like, white guy walks up with a Bible and a rosary, and I was like, I'm dead. Jesus, this was not a good idea. And I was like, just gotta go. Just gotta trust. You know, being freaked out. And some of you might feel that today. I think it'll be in a lot safer, you know, environments, but you still might have that feeling, right? When you're not used to being vulnerable, when you're not used to being in a world that you can control. That can happen anywhere. I didn't have to go to the prison to come. Well, I give that story that I went, and as soon as I read the gospel, and I had another volunteer with me, and we just broke open the word, and we said, what do you hear? What's God telling you? And we just started talking. I was like, oh, dude, he's just my bro. We're just broken brothers, just sharing life. Except one of us got to live behind on the fence, and one of us was able to leave. Right? And then the other thing I heard in my heart, which I've heard from a speaker, Jerry Cole, so I think it's been heard down before, maybe in your schools. He tells a story when he started to visit the prison or a youth center, and he asks the young man, he's like, what do you want? The young man says, just come back. Just come back. This relationship. Just be with him. Right? We're not here to fix each other. Right? As you go this afternoon, we're not here to make everyone's life perfect or better, right? We might not be able to do anything other than maybe just sit in it. That's mercy. mercy is broken down in the church, we're all fancy like this, into what we call the corporal and the spiritual works of mercy. Big fancy words, we'll probably talk about this more as we go, but I just wanted to label it because this wouldn't be a good talk about mercy if I didn't actually talk about the corporal and spiritual works of mercy. So, we have feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, clothe the naked, shelter the homeless, visit the sick, visit the prison, bury the dead. I'm not positive, but I think you're pretty much doing at least all of those in some shape, manner, or form this afternoon, because Michelle's a genius like that, right? And the interesting thing, think of the story of the prodigal son. How many of those did he do in a very obvious way? He fed his son. He killed the, you know, killed the calf and threw a big party, much to the other son's chagrin, right? He's like, dude, where's my party? Right? And the father's like, you're here all the time. Life is good, right? But he was gone and now he's back. That's why we're throwing a party, right? Give drink to the thirsty. He clothed him, right? Shelter, he welcomed him back to his home. Those are the most obvious, right? So if you look into the stories when the church teaches these things, it's not like randomness, right? We're pulling this out of the witness and the words of Jesus in the Gospels. And sometimes it can be hard to be like, bury the dead, what do I do about that, right? Well, you know, you can pray for the dead, but you can also visit, right? You know, at the Irish tradition, when someone dies, we throw a party. It's kind of just this weird thing that we do. They call it a wake. And the body, they'll bring the coffin often into the home. And then they'll pray and they'll visit, right? And so to me, that's bury the dead. That's part of what we do. I'm not literally digging the hole. It's the tradition of the family. And then usually we throw a big party, not for the sake, but it's also, we swap stories. And it's usually fun and craziness, but then around 1 o'clock in the morning, everybody starts breaking down. We start getting to a level of vulnerability and comfort that we just sit there. And I remember when my Uncle Dennis died of a heart attack, there's 40 of us in the basement, and it goes into my birthday at 1 in the morning, and I sang You Are My Sunshine, and I passed around a cup and I made $40, which is kind of weird, but it's an Irish thing. But I just remember all these grown men, my aunts, you know, my aunt, my uncles, my dad, you know, my grandparents and that kind of stuff, people that never showed emotion, just breaking down and crying. And it wasn't awkward, right? We just allowed, we created a space that we could just be. Corporal works of mercy are going into each other's places and spaces and serving simply, right? And sometimes you're like, well, I don't maybe have an option. I don't know someone who's sick or that kind of stuff. Well, for us, like as a parent, right, I'm limited with young crew that what I can do all the time. So sometimes a corporal work of mercy is me getting out of bed and feeding my kid the first time they ask. Or it's like, you know what, I can go make pancakes and I can mix the batter with Jacinta and she can pour it and we can do the dishes together. We can enter into it together. So you gotta own these and make them real to your state of life, right? And then we have the spiritual works of mercy, right? Counsel the doubtful, instruct the ignorant, admonish sinners, comfort the afflicted, forgive offenses, bear wrongs patiently. That one I was always like, who's patiently and what did bear do wrong? I always think of this bear, it's patiently, and then it feels bad about it, right? What does it mean to bear, right, to carry, you know, to not snap on people, right? When that annoying classmate is beside you, to be patient, to try to listen, to try to understand someone who's different than you, right? To get into their space, and pray for the living and the dead, and to pray. So, I invite you, as you go forth today and all that good stuff, we have the C2L praying. There's that little board. I encourage you, maybe when you go on that sticker, if you know what you're going to do or what you're afraid about or whatever, put that on a sticker and say, I'm going to try to be patient with my brother and sister. Can you pray for them? Right? I'm going to talk to people and I don't like talking. Now pray for me. Right? Let them pray the journey with you, right? As they work on the spiritual work of mercy. So, I've been waiting a long time for this. You need to be like a penguin. That makes no sense. We will watch this.
On the coast of southeast Brazil, a penguin has made himself at home with an unlikely companion. For the last 4 years, this Magellanic penguin has been hanging out with a retired bricklayer named João Pereira de Souza. The penguin, nicknamed GG, disappears into the ocean for as much as 4 months at a time. But when he comes back, it's always to De Souza's shanty by the sea. De Souza found GG in 2011, soaked in oil and lying on the beach in front of his house. He fed the bird some sardines and gave it a shady spot to rest, and he hasn't been able to get rid of GG since. Despite their reputation as cold water animals, the birds have been known to turn up in the warm waters of Brazil, where a northbound current occasionally drops them off on tropical beaches like this one in Rio de Janeiro State. But local fishermen have never seen anything like this.
The funniest thing is, the penguin might stay here for a week, then it walks down to the beach and leaves. It spends 10, 12, 15 days, then comes back to the same house. They're supposed to join together, find some path to the south, but he doesn't.
Jingjing regularly goes to sea for days, weeks, or months at a time, only to waddle his way back to Mr. De Souza's home. He usually spends about 8 months of the year here, and the bond between the two has become pretty strong. De Souza says Jingjing won't allow other animals to get anywhere close to him.
Jingjing, come on, that's adorable. So, you need to be penguins for Jesus. Trust me, it makes sense. It's not just craziness, right? It says in the article, I don't think it was in the video, that they believe that Jingjing comes back because Jingjing believes that Juan is a penguin. Because the way that he was treated and that kind of stuff, that like, it's like the idea of like imprinting. He thinks it's a fellow penguin. He's got his back, right? And it's like the prodigal son. He's like the prodigal penguin. He comes back all the time, right? Why? Because he has a home, he has a safe space where he has been loved. For Jingjing knows that no matter what I do, my craziness of going out and mating up on the islands, I can always come home to João. Right? Penguins for Jesus. Can you be like João? Can you be so loving and merciful and enter into someone's reality, right? And get to know them and their situation that they believe and they see that you are Christ with them in that moment. Can you draw so close, right, and open up your hands and your hearts to let God flow through you that they see and encounter God and only God? May you be penguins for Jesus. And to do that, and we'll wrap up with this, you need to be grateful. You need to be grateful with all that you have. In every moment, in every opportunity that you have this day and the next. If you are not grateful for what you have, you don't understand it as a gift. If you don't understand what you have in your life, in your family, in your friends, and in your talents, if you don't see it as, if you're not grateful and you don't see it as a gift, you will never give it away. So let's take a moment to be grateful for where we are sent.
The most valuable. next thing is to leave. You look, you open your